Hello, Kevin Bacon again. Today I'm going to do a different kind of a project. This is going to be a fairly real-time project for those of you out there that just like to watch the entire process. I'm going to take you from the forest to the ink pen, basically. What we have here in front of us is a piece of Osage orange, or hedge, as they call it, around where I live here. And it is a very nice, bright yellow wood when you work with it. Over a period of time, it will turn a golden brown. Typically, it has excellent highlights in the wood, and lots of fire, lots of beauty, and other things mixed into this wood. It's a very difficult wood to work with because it's hard, it's stringy, it tears out, it checks, it does all kinds of stuff. There are cracks. Even if you mill it properly, you're going to come up with cracks and checks in the wood. The grain generally grows spiral in nature instead of straight and true. So you have those kind of things. There are internal stresses in the wood. So as you cut it, it'll actually fight. It's an amazing stuff to work with. It's a very dense wood. It just barely floats. It has a lot of oil in it, so it burns really, really well. And of course, it is very flexible. That's why the French beau d'arc, meaning the arc of the bow, it was used for making bows in times past. I have a lot of this wood here. I'm not sure that this particular branch came from my property, but it came within 30 miles from here. I picked it up probably up by Sibley when I hauled some wood home for my son several weeks ago. Okay, it may very well have been harvested out here in my woods. I don't remember. In any case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to mill a piece of this down into a pen blank, then we're going to drill the blank, then we're going to glue the blank, and then we're going to turn the pen. And we're going to do all of that on camera. Now, between setups, obviously, I'm going to turn the camera off because, you know, that's make everybody seasick. But the processes themselves, I'll try to capture on camera so you can watch the whole thing. This is not necessarily for pen makers as much as it is for people that like to watch this kind of stuff. But if you're a pen maker, you might enjoy it too. First thing I need to do here is get a piece long enough for the pen that I'm working with. Typically, I work with a 5 or 6 inch pen blank. This is a 6 inch rule. That's a 15 centimeters. The only reason I know that is because it tells me it's 15 centimeters on here. I'm going to stick my ruler on here. I'm going to get me a generous another inch or so beyond that, which is about 7 inches or so, and make a mark. Doesn't have to be a real phenomenal mark because I'm just going to turn on the bandsaw and cut that baby off. Up of the end grain there, but we're working with. You can see that there are cracks in this wood, and this crack right here, if you look carefully at this crack, you'll see that the growth rings were interrupted. So that crack has been there since this branch almost started growing. There are other cracks, you can see them in here, that have been there since almost the beginning of this branch. So that's how this stuff grows. If you could hear it, it was fighting my saw the entire time. The end of the cut is smooth, almost like glass, because the fibers, not only are they being cut, but they're kind of being burnished because they fight their way back out and they get polished by the blade. It's really amazingly different stuff to work with. I'm really looking forward to getting up here into this curly knot. As you can see, there's a really nice curly knot there. I don't know what we're going to find in there, but the fork in this tree should make some really, really gorgeous stuff. Maybe maybe that's where we need to go with it today. This is pretty straight. All right, talk me into it. Basically, this is the creative process. You know, I look at the wood, I say, whoa, you know, maybe we can get something very nice out of that. Now, I'm thinking that this little branch here is, it may be a little bit on the small side for what I want to do, because I like to quarter these. But I think if we center here in the middle, I cut it off. Let's see, if I get 6 inches there, I'll have another blank, but I have some smaller ones. Okay, let's do that. Let's cut it off right about there. There's another knot. Another check that goes all the way to the heartwood, all the way down, naturally there. Nothing you can do about it. You got them. Whether you like it or not, they're there. You see the saw blade burned the wood just a little bit there because it pinched in on the blade as we went along. Now, what I want to do with this, it isn't straight. We need straight. And I want to come up straight about like that. You see, here's the curve, and I want to come up straight right through about right there. We need a piece about the size of this ruler when we're done. And so what I have to do is set up a fence on my saw, figure out how this will lay smoothly on the table, set up the fence here next to my blade so that I can push the wood through the blade, take a small piece off there, go down there, take a small piece off, and remain pretty good. Now, what I may have to do instead is work on this side, the high side, so I can take a sliver off at a time, and that way when I get through, it doesn't tip over. So that's probably what we'll do. We'll go through this direction and we'll slowly shave a piece off and mill it down until we get where we want to be. Then we'll move over 3/4 of an inch and mill a piece off. And that will give us our basic blank. So let me set up a fence and I'll get right back. I bought this saw used and it didn't come with a fence on it. But that's not really a problem because I have some large bar clamps. And what I do is I take a piece of nice straight wood. This happens to be maple, I believe, from a futon that I tore apart. And it reaches nicely across the saw. So I put a bar clamp on both ends. Then the saw table has these parallel grooves in it, and I use them to my advantage. I'll set myself up. Probably I want to take off a small sliver to begin with, so we'll set this up fairly close to the blade and then and just move it over as we go along till we get where we want to be. And it's a little bit slower process than it might be if you had a guide already built onto the saw, but It's not that tedious. And then when I get pretty close to where I want to be, I reach over and I grab that little mallet that I made and I make my final adjustments with the mallet. I look down at my parallel grooves and line them up at both ends. In this case, it doesn't have to be a precise process because I'm just trying to get a flat surface. So as long as we're going parallel to the blade, we're pretty good. Now I'm using a 3/8 blade on this bandsaw, so we can cut a pretty tight curve. So even if it's a little bit off, it's not going to make that much difference. See through it. Okay, we got a nice flat surface now, and actually I'm quite impressed. It's almost perfectly flat, so that'll make a nice surface to work up against as I go along to cut this down. So now the next step over from there I'm just going to take shavings off of that just like that until I get pretty close where I want. It'll be less likely for it to want to tilt. Now see, my guide was just about to hit this knot here. We're going to raise that up just a little bit. We can get past that and make another pass. Now, I am pulling almost as much as I'm pushing to keep this from rocking as I go through the blade. Get a look at some of that wood grain in there, some of those internal patterns and things that we're looking for. We have a nice check here. We notice that it's starting to get oval shaped in the grain because we're going around the corner. This check has grown over. It was probably a small branch that might have been there. We have some checks clear down in dead center in the middle of this that are grown over years ago, so they're way old. How old is this branch? I don't know. I can't count it. Maybe you can tell better on this one where it burned a little bit. Easily 10 or 12 years, probably. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, 12 or 13 years old in that little area. Not the whole tree, just this branch. Okay, now, you notice as we go along now that we're starting to change. And so it wants to tip over, and I'm going to have to keep that tight up against the fence if I'm going to maintain the same basic orientation that I've been having through the whole thing. So now I have to push it up against the fence while I push it through in order not to have it tip over or whatever, because the bottom edge is no longer touching the saw as it was before. Yes. Very nice. Very nice. Okay. Let's put our ruler on there. Okay. I think there's a check right here, a big check. We're going to have to avoid that check, but if you look at the end, it's checked quite a bit. So I'm going to have to stay to the other end of this. And we can do that, but we're going to have to move over at least one more time. Very nice. Very nice, very nice. I'm happy with that. You can see that it bound on the blade. You could hear it squealing when those internal stresses were getting at it. And what happens as that tree grows and the branch is weighted down, it grows longer on the top side and tighter on the bottom side. And then it gets more weight on it, and it gets more and more internal stresses as that goes along because it's such a flexible wood. So you end up with something quite interesting to work with. Let's cut that end off of there. Good. Excellent, excellent. Excellent, excellent. You can see I cut deep enough in there that I'm past the checking now, so I don't have to worry about those cracks being in the finished product. Now, I don't throw this away. I throw it over here in my box. And these little pieces like this, I really don't have a use for them, so they will go in the scrap pile. But now, it's a matter of taking a piece off of here that's about 3/4 of an inch. Now, what I want to do first is I'm going to lay this down, and I'm going to take this curve off this side against the fence, and that way I'll have two flat surfaces, not necessarily square and parallel to each other, but two flat surfaces. Flat surfaces. We're not quite far enough over to get into the part of the wood that I want to use for the pen yet, but we're getting very close. And I think if I take off one more slice, then we're going to be just about ready to take our 3/4 inch piece off that will actually end up being the blank itself. Thank you. what's happening in there is the grain is trying to make my blade wander and it goes offline, but hopefully you can get some idea of the beauty of the grain in that piece of wood. It is gorgeous. Maybe if we wet it down just a little bit, that may or may not help. But in any case, that I will keep. Now, I need to get over 3/4 of an inch and then over 3/4 of an inch. So now we're going to readjust our fence to 3/4 of an inch. I already showed you how I did that, so I'll do that off camera. For all you out there in centimeter land, 3/4 of an inch, 19 millimeters. 20 millimeters would be close enough. Now what I'm going to do is go down here and look at the end of this blade and see where we're going to be on that piece of wood. And it's going to put me down right there. And I think I'm going to be happy with that. So let's take that off. That almost gives me enough for another piece out of this wood. I'm hoping that I get 2 out of it. Yes, very nice, very nice. Okay, let's see what we get for the second one. Miss, 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 miss. Ooh. Not enough there for an ink pen, but maybe enough down here for one of my shorter body pens. Okay, I work with some ink pens that require a shorter piece of wood. So, we're going to keep this because it's got gorgeous grain in it. It's just remarkable. But we're going to work with this piece. Now, taking our ruler on here and laying it out, it's 5 inches is what we're going to have probably when we're done. We're going to end up with 5 inches. 5 inches is fine. That's why I start out with 7, so I end up with at least 5. And actually, with 5, we'll have plenty enough. Let's see. I'm going to cut that off. That will give me a piece. Yeah, I think we've cut this twice. Adjust your blade guide down there. No, I did not adjust my blade guide down there. I could have adjusted my blade guide down there, but it takes up time on the video. And in the case of these things, we're going to turn most of this wood away. So you're making a knife blank, and especially since I'm making it 3/4 and I only need 5/8 to work with, if this blade wandered a little bit, close enough is still going to be close enough. We're still in good shape on this thing. And I think you're going to find that you're going to have some woodworkers out there that take the time to do all that little stuff at every little time they practice. And then those of us that have been around for a while realize that there are times when close enough is close enough. Now, could we glue those two together? Yeah. Yeah, there's a tight enough joint there to get a glue joint. So that's close enough for me. Okay, we're going to go from this process now over to the drill press. Let's see, I need to knock the ends off square. That one's not square, well, square-er. I started working on a bandsaw in high school back in 71. Might have been 72. Probably the spring of 71. One thing I can tell you, it is one of the most fun tools in my shop for a lot of things. I can do fancy little scroll work. I can do all kinds of stuff on this bandsaw that I can't do on something else. I can actually mill by working sideways across the blade, and so I can make a couple of plunge cuts. Then I can cut from the angle, and I can mill the inside. You can get all kinds of fancy with this bandsaw, and yet you can cut yourself. I've cut myself a couple times. Not really severely, but just those little blade touches that get you. Remarkable tool, thoroughly enjoyable to have around the shop. You know, once you get used to it, probably one of the safest tools, as long as you use a little bit of sense when you're working with it. This is maybe 3/16 thick. Now we're just milling off. Okay. Cut a groove in it, mill the bottom of it, and whatever you were going to do, it fits on. Okay. That's not about ink pens. Okay, now what I have to do is determine the lengths of this hedge that I need for each of the two brass tubes on the pen blank. So, let's go look at that. The pen that I'm working on today requires two tubes. There's a long tube and a short tube. We'll lay them on here on the blank. Then I'm going to make a line, and I make that just a little bit longer than necessary. I'm going to go across both blanks here because I'm both doing them both at the same time. Then I'm going to put the long blank on here. Make a line at the end of the long blank. The long blank is the upper. This is the lower. Then I'm going to make a line down the blanks and across on this one like that. Down the blank and the other way across. That way I can differentiate these two pieces of wood from each other, and we know the orientation they're going to go in the lathe and to each other. So we turn the machine back on, find that line, trim it off. Now I'm squaring it up by pressing it down against the fence over here. I'm not removing the fence because it just takes too much time. Okay, we have our upper and our lower from this one. We have our upper and our lower from this one. And this one has a knot right in the middle of it. I'm just looking at the grain here to see which one I want to do on camera. And I think we're going to work with this one. Okay, that's decided. All right, let's get set up on the drill press and I'll show you how I do that. Okay, what we're going to do is start out with a blank. We're sticking in this is a simple little, actually this is for making picture frames, a 90 degree frame, but it works good for me. I can put my blank in here, give it a little bit of a tighten to it. It's parallel, or it's perpendicular to the drill bit this way. And I know that because I've checked it. In order to get perpendicular the other direction, I run the drill down, and I tighten up here at the top. There's a there's a screw that I can screw in here that'll hold the drill press down for me. Okay. Then I bring the blank up against the drill bit until it touches the drill bit, and push it forward until the drill bit and the blank are touching smoothly top to bottom. And when they're doing that, then I crank this vise down really tight. Now, a side view from that would be just like that. You see, the bit is up tight against the blank. We have no gap from the top to the bottom. We know that we are perpendicular to this blank. Now, we have got a lot of tolerance in an ink pen because the thickness of this blank is not a whole lot. So a lot of you go through trouble of dead centering and whatnot. What I do is I bring the bit down till I'm pretty close to the top, and I look at it from two or three different angles until I get where I want to be, and I turn the drill on and make some more looks. I'm going to touch it with the bit a little bit like that. I'm going to look at it. I'm going to adjust a little bit. And I noticed that my vise is rocking a little bit, so I'm going to come back down here and check and make sure that we haven't knocked ourselves off square. And we'll drill her down. Okay, smooth, even pressure. Had to make sure I wasn't right smack in front of him. Because the idea is to see what I'm doing here, not to see my elbow. This particular drill bit clears chips pretty well, so I usually don't have to go forward and backward. Some woods you do, the harder woods you don't. It'll squeak at me if it gets to be too packed up. And we're out the bottom. Okay, not perfectly dead center on the bottom, but we have plenty of margin there to work with, I believe, to cut our pen. Looks like it'll be fine. Okay, do our other half. Exactly the same way. Now, one thing about this hedge, once again, the grain is really squirrely, so it'll cause that drill bit to wander as it goes through. There's not a lot I can do about that. These drill bits are a little bit flexible. I could run the bit a little bit faster, but then it tends to burn. So and there's got to be some mystery in the wood when you're done, too. Oh, very nice. Almost dead center. Once again, you can see it wandered a little bit, but we've still got plenty of meat here to get the ink pen done. So now what we got to do is glue in our brass and over to the lathe. Next, we're on to the glue. I use a thick CA glue for a lot of my ink pens. A lot of my ink pens, I use a 5-minute epoxy. Today, we're going to use the thick CA glue because that's where I happen to be. It's very simple. I have here a very simple pick out of a pick set. And I know that this isn't its intended purpose, but it works. It works for what I'm going to do with it. I stick the brass tube on the pick. You could use a small Phillips screwdriver. You can buy one of those fancy insertion tools. Doesn't make any difference. Whatever pushes it in. I pushed it in with my fingers for a long time, but after a period of time, that gets a little bit sticky. I got this big old can of activator. So I spray activator inside the tube and out the other side. Then I take my stuff, and that stuff stinks. Well, all this glue stuff stinks. And I put a liberal coat around and around on the brass. Like that. Make sure I've got the right one. Push it in there. Shove it in until it comes out pretty well even. Boom. That's that. Set it off to the side. Do the other one. This has got a piece of something sticking up there. The glue will stick to this tool, but it won't stick to the plastic very well. So one of these, I glued it all up, took it over to my trimmer, trimmed it. The brass tube stuck on the trimmer, and I had to use my metal lathe to get it off. So, you know, you're going to run into some situations every once in a while. And I happen to have a metal lathe in my other room, so I just took it in there and chucked it in the lathe and machined off that piece of stuff. There we go. Now, and I'm done with that. I take my activator, I shoot the end of the wood. Now we're going to let them set until the glue cures. Not very long. You'll be able to tell. It gets hard. But if you get in a hurry, like I say, when you go to your trimmer, you're going to have a problem. So usually by the time I get from here to the trimmer and everything, we're in good shape. By the time I get the camera set up on the trimmer, we should be pretty well ready to drill or to trim. This is what I use for a trimmer. It's another drill press. It's a small drill press. I have it set at a medium speed, not too terribly fast. Right behind it happens to be my dust collector, so I don't need that on right now. We're not making a bunch of dust. Okay, I turn it on. I start it up in there like that. I let it go down. I mill a little bit off. And I take it out and I look. And this has got about an eighth of an inch to go before it gets to the tube. So we're going to mill down a little at a time until we get to that piece of brass tubing. There we go. Shiny brass. The other side. shiny brass. Not quite. Good. No, one more time. Still not quite. There we go. Now, I don't know, but if you can see, you get to the point where you can see that you've touched the brass. That's all I need to do is just touch the brass. It squares up the end, and you can actually give it an idea where your profile is going to be when you're done, because you've cut a circle with it. All right, next thing, set up the lathe. This particular ink pen uses three bushings. I have a top bushing. And we're going to put our top piece on here, which we call the upper. And I want that there. Then it has a middle bushing there. Then it has the lower there. Now the lower is not fitting. So what we do there, and it's because the brass in here has a little burr on it. So what I have is a little round file. This happens to be for sharpening chainsaws. And I just deburr that piece of brass nicely like that. And I'll do the other end. And that way it should slip on smoothly. And there, our orientation is exactly the same as what the wood was. Now, it's a little bit skewed because the holes weren't perfectly drilled, but it lends character. Now, all we need is the top bushing and a little spacer. There's the end bushing, which this is actually the nib end of the pen. And then there's a final bushing on there that's just a spacer. Now, I draw my tailstock up. I'm going to run this out a fair ways here. Bring it up there tight, clamp it down, give it some good torque. I am set up. A little slower than I want to be. I think we'll go a little faster than that. It would have been the third step on this lathe, but I think I'm going to want to go a little faster. Set my speed about right there. Let's see how that goes. Oh yeah, I like that. Oh, bring over our tool rest. Lock it down. Get in a little bit closer. Reach around here. Now, if you watched my video the other day about my tools, you may have an idea of what I'm going to grab first. Round nose scraper. And we'll be using this round nose scraper the same as we would a gouge. Rub the bevel, raise the back, and it will start to cut off pieces. Tighten it up a little, get a little better. Good. But if you were looking, if you can see what's coming back here on my hand, what's coming on my hand is shavings, not sawdust. Let's modify our approach here, and we'll get our 3/8 spindle gouge here. We'll see what we can do with that. It's such hard wood. I keep reaching over and tightening up the tailstock in an effort to get okay, that's pretty well right. Back to my gouge, or to my scraper. I'm going to reach over and I'm going to grab my skew. Let's see if we can do a little skew work here. Oh yes, perfect. Good. Good skew. It's a pretty handy tool. Now we want to get flat on here, and I'm not seeing my flat nosed scraper. There it is. Flat nosed scraper. Then what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to profile this nice and smooth and flat all the way across until we get down to the diameter we want. I'm taking very, very, very tiny little bit of material. I still got to go down almost a 1/16 of an inch in thickness here in order to match this, and I see a little tear out. So we're going to work very, very gently now. Because a tear out could be disastrous at this point. Take a look at that. What do we do? Okay, we cut through our tear out. We're almost down to the bushing, and we're almost down to the bushing at the other end. So I'm not going to do any more tool work on that half, except take my flat scraper again and just very gently even it out. Take a look. Oh yes, and the grain is gorgeous. Now I was hoping for that. That's why I got that particular piece that I got. This is where everything has to be so careful. Just a smidge hair more there, and we should be good. Good. Okay. The lower now is ready for sanding and finishing. Now let's work on the upper. The upper is a little bit different in that we're going to have a square end and a bluntly rounded over end. So I have a set of calipers already set up for the diameter that I need for the barrel of the back of this in order to match where I'm going. So having these set up, I'm going to take my parting tool. Here. Going to get it oriented the way I want it. And I'm working so carefully because this wood will split. We could take our skew and we can bring that back Now we're going to bring this down gently. Like that. Take a look. Oh my. Almost requires no sanding at all. We got a little tiny tear out there, but that'll sand right out of there, I think. Okay. Now, we have to take the parting tool now, and we have to make a small tenon here because there's a band that goes on this ink pen in the middle. So we'll cut our tenon. Now what I'm going to do is get the band right over here, and we'll just test it. It needs to be just a hair, tiny little bit smaller. I know that they want you to put the band on here and turn and move it, but I find that I hit my tool on the band once in a while, and I don't like tool marks on these fancy bands. So, so close. So close. Okay, if I hit that with a little sandpaper, that'll be fine. Not only that, I'll be able to tap that band on there nicely. So, we're ready to hit this with some sandpaper. See, the next step is to this is a very hard wood, and it is fairly rough. So I'm going to start out with some 150 sandpaper here. I rarely go any coarser than 150 when I'm working with these because I cut them so closely. The skews and whatnot, that I have a pretty good finish. Okay, we're going to file that tenon down a little bit. Thank you. getting some dust here. What I normally do is I have a fan and I put on the end of my lathe here, and it blows the dust over, and I turn on my dust collector in the air. It's a big filter that filters that off, and I need to work on right here. But they are so noisy that you would not be able to hear me if I had them cranked on. Oh, that's very nice. Very happy with that. Very, very happy. Okay. I'm going to give this big one, top one, a little bit more because it's had that tiny little bit of tear out. Then we're going to swap over from 150 to 100. I'm sorry, I went the wrong direction. 150. Sometimes I use 100. We go to 220. From 150 to 220. The numbers get bigger, not littler. That's what happens when you're working on camera. Well, actually, that's what happens to me all the time. My brain goes backwards regularly. 220. And I can see it shining already with just this 220. Yes, very, very nice. Very nice. Okay. Now, the next step I go to, a lot of you cringe at, and I've heard it, and I've heard a lot of people say, you know, they don't use steel wool. But I like steel wool. This is 4-aught steel wool, which amounts to 440 sandpaper. But the difference is, it doesn't make the same kind of scratches. And so, if you press that steel wool up against the bottom of that, now I'm gonna tell you, if you're working with acrylic, steel wool will burn and stick. Don't use steel wool on your acrylic. But, especially on these really hard woods, I'm starting to get a shine, almost like a finish, just with that steel wool. That's it. It's ready for finish. It is almost as shiny now as it's going to be after I put on the finish. All right. Now I've got to go get something to finish it with. I'll be right back. For my finish, I have been using this HUT Hut Crystal Coat. I like it. It's fast. It's easy. It's basically a finish that is a friction polish that I didn't have to mix up. The other thing is, I use an old sock. Now, I know a lot of people say, oh, don't ever use a cloth on your lathe. It'll get you in trouble. Well, I don't get the finish out of the paper towels that I like. And I can use this sock over and over and over until it's all wore out. And then I throw it away. I just It's what I've gotten used to. So if you don't want to use a sock, that's fine. I do. So what I'm going to do first is take some of this polish and put it on my rag. And I turn the lathe around by hand and get a nice coat of it soaking into that wood. Lots of it in there so that it really, really gets a chance to penetrate, because once that first coat is dry, the rest of them are just going on top. They're not going down under. And I am spinning fairly fast right now, but it'll be okay. I stand off to the side, so if it does fly out, it doesn't get me. Then I just slowly work back and forth across there with that wet spot on the rag. And I can watch and I can see where I'm working by looking at the sheen on the pen blank itself. And I'll just take a little bit more and put it on there. You see a little bit of it'll fly once in a while, but I'm not behind it. After I get that good and saturated and a couple, three, maybe four coats on it, then I turn my sock over, find a dry spot, and just give her a light buff. Now you gotta remember to store these rags in a fire safe container, because there are some finishes that will spontaneously combust. You don't want that happening in your house or in your garage. Oh my, that is just wow, way too gorgeous. But I gotta do one other thing to it before I'm done. This is a big hunk of beeswax. Take my big hunk of beeswax and I just run it down the line like that. And I take my rag one more time, push it on there, heat it up, back and forth. And there we are. Now I'm going to move the camera over here and give you a look at this blank before we take it out of the lathe. Okay, this is where it all gets worthwhile. Let's see here. And I'm going to change that a little bit so we can... I think we'll just take it off. Isn't that something? This was a stick on the ground a short while ago. Just a stick. And now you can see that gorgeous, gorgeous grain pop right out of that stick. Let's take it in the other room and put this pen together. Perhaps the most difficult part of this video is getting things lined up where you can actually see what I'm doing. Because I usually try to work with me in mind rather than working with somebody else in mind. So let's get this thing knocked together. Okay, first thing I need to do is glue that little ring there onto the tenon. Put a little bit of thick super glue around the tenon. Put the bushing on. Tap it gently into place. And wipe off the excess glue. And that's it. And I left that beauty ring just a little bit proud, which is fine. Now, there's another trick you can pull right here, right now. If you get a little bit of glue on this collar, you can take it right back out and stick it in the lathe and buff that collar to buff off the excess glue. Okay, while that dries, we're going to assemble the lower. And I do this a little bit more radically, perhaps, than I've seen. I take my nib here, I place it into the end of the barrel, then I take this nylon hammer and I tap it gently around and around, making minor adjustments to keep it going straight until it's all the way down and flush. Now, why do I do that? Well, I've used the arbor press to press these and just about ruined them. So, if you tap them gently and you keep adjusting when you get down there, you end up with the exact results, well, that I want. Now, if it works out better for you to do it the other way, by all means. Now, I'm going to put in the transmission. I'm going to do similarly. I'm going to stand the transmission up. Now, the first thing I do is run the transmission to the top. And I start it into the pen, and I'll tap it gently until I get it started straight. That's all I want. I just want it started straight. Because now I have to take the ink pen filler, place it in the pen, run it down in, and then check. And right now, the tip of the pen is exactly or almost exactly at the end of this nib. So take the filler back out again. Reach over here onto the arbor press. Raise the arbor press up. Knock the board off. Place the pen in the arbor press. And I need about 3/16. So we'll just press it in about 3/16 and stop. Reinstall the filler. Screw it down in where it belongs. Now I'm just out about half the distance I want. And I do that process again. I know there's a line on there to follow, but I found that line can get you in trouble depending on how you trimmed up that brass tube. So it's better for me to sneak up on it, and there I am, exactly where I want to be. And when I back it off, it disappears far enough so that it won't get on you. The bottom half of the pen is now complete. We'll set it off to the side. I am going to go polish this collar on the lathe, and then we will put the last part, and that's the clip, on here and put it together. We'll be done. Okay, had I a buffer set up down here, I wouldn't have needed to do that, but I don't have a buffer here in the basement. So the next thing we're going to do is to put the clip on the back of the pen. Now, I always look carefully around the pen to find the place on the back of the pen that has the least amount of character. And man, when you're looking at this stuff, that is really, really hard to decide. But I think right down that, man, that's too much like Tiger Eye. There isn't any such place. That's terrible. So, the nice thing about these clips is that the top will unscrew a tiny little bit and you can change its orientation. So I place the clip into the back of the pen, once again with my little nylon mallet. There it is. It is now secure. You take the top half of the pen and the bottom half of the pen, push them together. And it's done. Now, if you noticed, when I pushed that together, the brass tube came out. So that means, and this has never happened to me before, that means that the CA glue did not bond to the inside of the pen. Not to worry, we'll just put another coat on there and shove it right back together again. Everything will be fine. I'll do that and I'll get back with you here in a second. Well, there it is. From the forest to a pen. That is some gorgeous wood. I hope you enjoyed it. Ken Bacon. Bye for now.